Our host for this program, Mr. Paul Robeson, Jr.
Thank you very much. Good evening. We invite you to share with us the joy and pain, the challenge and excitement of the greatest moments in my father's life. Although Paul Robeson was extraordinarily multi-talented, he was best known throughout the world as a great singer. And more than anything else, it is his music that will continue to live on after him. So it is appropriate to touch briefly on the sources of his musical genius. There was his formidable talent. There was his consummate acting ability and dramatic power. There was also his spiritual commitment, his attitude toward his talent. As a young man of 32, he said, "The talents of an artist are God-given. Having been given, I must give. Man shall not live by bread alone, and what the farmer does, I must do. I must feed the people with my songs." And there was his meticulous and constant scholarship. He studied languages and cultures, and he analyzed his music and lyrics in minute detail so that they flowed effortlessly whenever he sang. Because Paul Robeson was such a great artist, his social activism carried an enormous impact. He was, and still is, controversial because he challenged the cultural foundations of racism in America. He was, and he remains, the symbol of the black man who uncompromisingly insists on full equality. As he put it, "I am looking for freedom, full freedom, not an inferior brand." One of his greatest contributions was to fight unceasingly to make it acceptable for artists, especially black artists, to take a stand on social issues. He believed they had not only a right, but also the responsibility to speak out according to their consciences. He wrote, "The artist must elect to fight for freedom or for slavery. I have made my choice. I had no alternative." The film you are about to see, Paul Robeson Tribute to an Artist, captures the essence of Paul Robeson. Written and directed by Saul Terrell, narrated by Sidney Poitier, it is a labor of respect and love which speaks for itself. Come with me, then, to look through this window on black history so that together we may be enriched by the unforgettable nobility of Paul Robeson. Those who wish to ask questions, if you'd find the usher nearest to you, they will bring you to the microphones one by one. But I want to say that just, although I've seen this film very many times, I'm always deeply moved whenever I see it. Then it takes me a little while to collect my thoughts. So please feel free to ask any questions you might have on your minds. I hope that some of the old and dear friends of the Robeson family who are here tonight, as well as others who have encountered my father, will share with us briefly some of their recollections.
As a voice and speech coach, Paul Robeson has been a role model for my students for many, many years. And I wondered if you could give us some insight into, from the point of view of phrasing and diction, what was going on in his head and heart as he spoke the words of the great poets like the Roman orators and Disraeli and Keats.
You ask the easy ones, I see. Okay, I'll take a crack at that on a couple of levels. He learned Othello in four languages: French, German, Russian, Yiddish. Why? The French, when he's talking about Desdemona, French is almost like a caress, one level. The German for a certain militaristic, a certain sharpness when he's talking about the wars of Cyprus. The Russian because certain musical tones give an extra impetus to a line. And they gave him the idea of where to emphasize a line. It's a very musical up and down language. Yiddish for the humor, because Othello is a heavy, heavy, heavy play. You gotta lighten up sometime. He felt that he should find out where Shakespeare got his language from. So he went back to the ancient Anglo-Saxon from which the Elizabethan came, studied the ancient Anglo-Saxon, then he studied the role in the Elizabethan language that Shakespeare actually wrote in. Finally, he studied the ancient Moorish culture, the ancient Venetian culture, put all that together, and that was the result of his memorable performance, still considered the performance of Othello this century.
Paul, as you know, many of us are aware of your father's great exploits in athletics, but there's still one great social injustice, which you and I both know about, which I will mention now. That is that Paul Robeson, one of the greatest football players of all time, is not in the College Football Hall of Fame.
I would add one fact to Dr. Brown's comments about my father's prowess. He was an All-American for 2 years, and if you can imagine him standing 6'3½", 220 pounds, could run the 100-yard dash in 11 seconds flat in the high-top shoes, could throw the forward pass, was one of the greatest middle linebackers of all time, was the prototype type tight end, and ran the end around and was able to pass from running the end around. He also played, interestingly enough, in the first professional Super Bowl in history for Akron against the Chicago Bears in 1922. Rutgers University has repeatedly sponsored my father. Many institutions, individuals, have supported his entry into the Hall of Fame, but since the Board of Trustees of the College Hall of Fame, it is a private institution, and that board is extremely conservative. It is doubtful that any public pressure can do anything more than embarrass them. My own feeling is that they're so conservative that until there is a new board, they won't induct my father for both racial and political reasons.
I graduated from Columbia Law School, and I just discovered several years ago that Paul Robeson graduated from Columbia Law School, and there was a feat for him here at Columbia, and Dean Albert Rosenthal was asked, why so long? Why did it take so long to have a ceremony? And he said, well, it wasn't as if you met him at alumni functions.
Dean Rosenthal was being, let's say, overly subtle. The fact is that for years, the Columbia trustees would not have allowed Dean Rosenthal to mention my father's name or any other dean of Columbia University. In fact, the legal profession, including the best legal minds at Columbia at that time, found it easy to acquiesce in the illegal deprivation, in the illegal confiscation of my father's passport by the State Department. They suddenly found that the Constitution didn't apply to Paul Robeson. I'm quite sure that they would not like to recall those rather infamous times and would prefer to simply say that they've rediscovered my father.
Who were the major influences of your father during this time, those thinkers or scholars that best reflect the mission and the aspirations as espoused by your father during his leadership? Thank you.
All right, the first, perhaps the most important influence on my father was his father, a runaway slave, who was fought with the Union Army, educated himself, and became a minister in Princeton and Somerville, New Jersey. He's a man of great dignity, and Dad said of him that he had an even more resonant bass voice than he did. He learned from my grandfather the art of speaking. My grandfather was a great orator. It's an ancient West African tradition. And my father grew up in the church and learned the art of speaking. We also got several principles from my grandfather, and those were briefly, first, be the best that you can possibly be. Secondly, success in itself has no meaning unless you move ahead, are a trailblazer for your oppressed people. And finally, perhaps most important of all, be true to your principles. He studied African languages, cultures, and found the connections between African culture and the Afro-American cultural tradition here. He met many African and Asian leaders, including Nnamdi Azikiwe of Nigeria and Jomo Kenyatta, the Burning Spear, the first president of Kenya. All these leaders had a great influence on my father because it was there that he found his African roots.
Mr. Robeson, is there a contradiction with Paul Robeson being seen on one hand as a forerunner of the Black Power movement and at the same time being seen as an integrationist?
Good question. I think the problem is in part with the definitions, as if there are only two things, either black liberation or an integrationist. The fact is, my father, being a very wise man, took the best from both concepts. In brief, he was opposed to separatism because he believed that there was no future for blacks in the United States with an attempt to produce and create a separate economy and political system as a minority within the United States. On the other hand, he firmly believed in independence, political and cultural independence within the black community, that their leaders should be totally independent of any outside control, and that, as he put it, the Negro power, forerunner of black power, should be the source of strength to enable black Americans as a group to contend for and achieve political and economic equity in the United States, not only civil rights. As he put it, civil rights is only the first step on the road to equal opportunity and an equal share, an equitable share.
Before I ask my question, I'm another member of the Paul Robeson Interns, sponsored by Mahan Valley. And from seeing this film, I see where the youth group got its name, because your father has achieved a lot, and the staff in Mahan Valley is all about making us achieve our goals and not letting us turn back or give up. And my question is that, what were some of the subjects that your father spoke for or against that they took away his passport?
Yeah, very good question, because interestingly enough, the State Department's brief mentioned in almost in passing his radicalism and so on, but picked out one essential thing in terms of his passport. They said, in effect, anybody should be able to understand what an enormous problem it would be for the United States of America for this recognized leader of the Negro people to be traveling abroad urging and demanding and supporting independence for the colonial peoples of Africa and Asia. Any idiot should understand why we can't give the man a passport for that.
Would you happen to know, like, what motivated your father to take, you know, his beliefs so far?
I think that his determination came from his belief in a principle that you do what is right, not what is expedient. One example, when he came back in 1949 from Europe after having made those speeches, specifically the one at the Paris Peace Conference, he was told by an old friend who was really speaking for the State Department, in effect, that if he would be willing to stop making speeches, didn't have to take anything back, just stop making speeches, that in a year or so everything would be quieted down and he would be forgiven, he could have his own television show, anything he wanted. If he did not, the message was, Paul, you're going to need life insurance, not career insurance. He decided to continue the way he was going. That was the way he was. Yes.
This is a question more nearly about American culture than it is about Paul Robeson. There's a continuing perception that, for example, Paul Robeson went into self-exile in the Soviet Union for a long period of time. There's also the view that Paul Robeson was somehow nearly a traitor when he expressed views that were not very different than those that the NAACP had expressed during World War II. Yet these views persist, and I wondered if you wanted to comment on that.
Mm-hmm. I think that is important because perhaps the biggest myth that the establishment and its media have spread about my father, that he was a disillusioned exile, self-exiled to the Soviet Union. I think that's the standard phraseology. Nothing could be further from the truth. The fact is that he was locked inside the United States for 9 years, even prevented from traveling to countries where you don't need a passport, like Mexico, Alaska, Hawaii. He was confined to the continental United States by special presidential order, unprecedented for someone not under indictment, which he certainly was not. So he was locked in, not out, and it's fair to say that when he was abroad, his base was always in London, not in the Soviet Union. He traveled to the Soviet Union often, visited often, but he always lived in London when he was abroad, the center of the English-speaking theater, quite natural. Finally, he was ill for the last 15 years of his life, but unbowed. As a matter of fact, he rejoiced in seeing on television and elsewhere thousands of people saying and doing what he was persecuted for 10 and 20 years earlier. As a matter of fact, one of his last messages, he said, and I quote, I want you to know that I am the same Paul, dedicated as ever to the worldwide cause of humanity for freedom, peace, and brotherhood. Now, the reason for the myth is that a black man who challenges the cultural foundations of racism must become the black sheep who returns crestfallen and asks forgiveness.
Mr. Robeson, I understand your father visited the Soviet Union in the 1930s. Could you please tell us what his impressions were of the USSR of the 1930s?
He visited the Soviet Union often, the 1930s and 1940s and 1950s. His initial impression was primarily cultural. He came at the invitation of Sergei Eisenstein, a great Russian filmmaker, who wanted to do a film called Black Majesty about the great Haitian liberator Toussaint L'Ouverture. My father spoke Russian by then, and people had heard his singing over the radio in Russian. So he was popular because of his voice. They knew who he was. Also, he found himself accepted without a tinge of racism. And the most impressive thing about the Soviet Union that he found was that they encouraged the flowering of all of the cultures of the Soviet Union rather than the melting pot theory, or what is often called in black circles as the integrationism, everyone must be homogenized. I think that was the most important feature of the Soviet Union. to him at that time. And I think that what made him controversial is that because his view that the interests of black people in the United States and the colored and colonial peoples throughout the world were his primary, always his primary concern, he came to the conclusion that the communist world were their allies in the struggle against imperialism and colonialism. He was outspoken about his radical political views. He made no secret of the fact that he saw a great deal of merit in Marxism, socialism, communism, whatever you want to call it. He certainly was not a member of any party, the Communist Party or any other party. He was not a communist in that sense, but he always thought that the name communist was an honorable one. And when McCarthyism came, he refused to abandon his communist friends or the ideological beliefs that paralleled or agreed with those of communists or socialists. Unlike many others in the United States who suspended the Constitution when it came to socialists, communists, etc. Constitution is either for everybody, or as people found out under McCarthyism, everybody loses some rights if somebody loses some rights.
It seems to me, I'm not exactly sure the dates, that your father first went to Russia in the 1930s.
Mm-hmm. 1934, to be precise.
Was he aware of the tremendous suppression of Russian visual and performing artists in the 20s? I'm talking about people like Malevich and many of the actors, painters, writers, which I know has been kept tremendously from Russian people, because I've talked to some Russian performing artists today and they didn't know about. Was he aware of their complete suppression of their avant-garde movements and their other experimental movement?
When my father went in the early 1930s, still 1934, it corresponded with an enormous flowering of Soviet culture, in particular the cultures of the minorities. So he was very much focused on the positives and was not aware of the history you speak of and of the history to come. Because of his commitment and his feeling that the interests of blacks and the colored peoples of the world were primary, although he was aware of the purges of the 1930s, not in their totality, of course, he chose not to criticize the Soviet Union because he did not think it would be in the interests of blacks, the liberation movements around the world, which the Russians at the time counterbalanced Western imperialism. So it was a judgment call. He did have, if you want to call it that, priorities in the things he undertook. Some people think that was a mistake. History will have to judge that.
I met Paul Robeson in 1940 at the University of Wisconsin, when he came to sing at the Union Memorial Hall at Madison, Wisconsin. He was a giant of a man then, and has remained a giant in my mind and a hero of mine since meeting him personally at that time. In addition to being a great athlete, in addition to being a great singer, he was a man of peace, and he had fought for world peace. And he, with Ben Spock and W.E.B. Du Bois and a whole raft of people who spoke for peace in the 50s, was a victim of what was then called McCarthyism. And the need for recognizing the need to fight for world peace is something that Paul Robeson gave to me as a young man. And today, as much as it was before, there is a need for understanding and detente with the Soviet Union, which is the big issue that Paul Robeson fought for, and that's what we all have to continue to fight for. And we have to use that spirit and that man's tradition and history for our own purposes in our own way.
I think if he were here, he would want us to learn from his example as a person of conscience, and figure out what we ought to do according to our own consciences. Because one thing he taught me above all else, and I was a mature man before I realized what a debt I owed him for that, is he taught me first and foremost to be my own person. Don't copy anybody else. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you again for coming. I hope you enjoyed your visit with my father. Thank you.